So my topic is understanding microservices architecture. I know this is one of the most popular buzzwords in maybe in 2015 and 2016. So I'm not going to repeat whatever the things that we have in Martin Fowler's article. I'm not going to reiterate on those things, but I'm trying to get the microservices architecture and its attributes and try to see how you can apply them in real world. So that would be my objective for next couple of minutes. Okay, so to start with microservices. So how many of you have heard about the concept, the word at least? Okay, pretty much everyone, right? And then the important question, how many of you have been using it at the moment or planning to use it? Okay, that's pretty good. We have pretty good numbers. Okay, so we can, of course, share your experience as well. So let me take you through the some of the architectural concept of the microservices and along with some real-world examples. Okay, so before moving into the microservices architecture, let's start with the monolithic architecture. So I'll take an analogy here. So this is a hotel, one of the Park Plaza hotels in London. So as you can see, this particular hotel has its all the features, all the services that are offered from the hotel are part of this gigantic building, right? Assume that you want to modify something. You want to modify maybe like a drastic modification, maybe a structural modification. You literally have to do that across the entire thing. Basically, you have to rebuild the entire thing. Right? And also, if something goes wrong in one room, like a fire, so entire system will collapse. Right? Okay, so taking those concepts forward, so how do we map this architecture into a software application? Right, so in a monolithic software application, all the functionalities are implemented and deployed into a single runtime. So that is similar to having a web application, having a software application deployed as a set of web applications into an application server. And most of the existing software applications, including ERPs, CRMs, are monolithic applications. And web services, I'm not saying SOA, but web services is, again, a monolithic application, because if you take any of the SOAP web service, it is having service with maybe dozens of operations with complex message formats. And often they are deployed into the same web services runtime. And I didn't say SOA is meant to be implemented that way, but SOA's implementation web services is implemented as a monolithic, on top of the monolithic architecture. So let's take a use case. So let's take an online retail store, which is having three different functionalities. One is inventory, shipping, and store. So these, you can consider these as three different services. And all these services are deployed into the same runtime. Right? So say that you want to modify something, like say that one particular service is going out of memory. Since they are on the same JVM, entire system basically collapsed. Right? And also if you want to do some modification, often you have to restart the entire instance without affecting all the other existing services. Okay, so let's go through the main characteristics of the monolithic architecture. So they are developed and deployed as a single unit, single monolithic glob. And in most cases, they are overwhelmingly complex, and it leads to maintaining, upgrading, and customization nightmares. You often have to redeploy the entire application. It can be a web application with multiple operations, but maybe you are doing a very minor change, but still you have to redeploy the entire application. And the main problem with that approach is when it comes to scaling, you need to scale based on the number of JVMs you are having. Maybe you are getting much more traffic into the shipping service, but you still have to scale the redundant inventory and store services as well. And as I said earlier, reliability, once is one minor bug can bring the entire system down. And it is pretty hard to innovate because say that you have two different development teams. One team favors, like they like to develop with Java, and another team like to develop their solutions with something like Go or C++ or some other language. So, but in most cases, a given organization is very tightly locked into a particular technology. So in that case, you, even if there are opportunities to be opportunities to innovate, you can't do that because of these technical constraints, because you have to develop all these things using a unified technology. Okay, so moving into the microservices architecture. So I started with the hotel, and this is another resort-style hotel back in Sri Lanka. So this is having almost all the features that are there in the previous hotel, but the structure and the implementation is different. So this is implemented as a set of, or say, these are the rooms. Rooms are implemented as completely independent entities. And there are different types of rooms, as well as there are controlling units, like restaurants. And also, if something goes wrong in one of these rooms, say there's a fire in one room, it won't affect the any of the existing other buildings. Right? So that is the, so this is the core concept of the microservices architecture. So, and if you want to do some modification, if you want to say you want to modify one particular room, you can do that without barely touching any of the other existing systems. Okay, so let's move ahead with the microservices architecture in the context of software. So it is defined as a suite of fine-grained services and independent services, as well as it runs on its own process and developed and deployed independently. So I think all the highlighted points are quite important to microservices architecture because it is more about developing independent services, deploying them independently, developing and deploying them independently. And often, in most cases, I have seen that in most of the articles available in the web, so this is explained as a segregation of the monolith into different services. In my opinion, that is incorrect because say that you have three different applications in your monolithic, three different services, web applications in your monolith. That doesn't mean that you can have, you should have only three different microservices. So trying to relate that to the previous example, so in my previous example, we had three different web applications, but when I convert that into the microservices architecture, I didn't segregate all the existing services, but we have four different microservices. So this segregation is done based by considering the business scope, domain, and various other factors. So here we have introduced another inventory, accounting, shipping, and store by looking at the business functionalities offered from the entire software solution. So along with that, I would like to talk about a couple of misconceptions in microservices architecture. There are a lot of comments on number of lines of code that you should have in a microservice. So that is kind of even Gartner commented on this particular misconception, saying this is incorrect. Lines of code that you have in your microservice is not relevant, and also the team size, as well as the term itself is misleading. Right? So micro means it's like a very small thing, but It is small in the sense of this business scope. So this is more about doing one thing well, right? Doing selecting one particular functionality and do that, be an expert in that functionality. And now, of course, we have seen quite a lot of people rebranding their web services. They may be having a few dozens of web services and they started rebranding them as we do have microservices, but they are not adhering to any of the microservices principles. Okay, so when it comes to designing microservices, it's quite important to consider about the size, scope, and the capabilities of the microservice. So one, so these are some of the best practices, some of the guidelines that you can use to design your microservice. One thing is single responsibility principle. You select one particular business functionality and implement that as a microservice. And also the scope, there should be clearly defined scopes. You can use domain-driven design principles, and you should always focus on the scope that a given microservice is addressing. And it is not about making the microservice small. You should have the right service to serve the right, serve the special business functionality. And always try to use agile and independent development methodologies that includes deployment as well. And in practice, microservices often have very few operations with very simple message format, but that is not a must. Okay, so moving into the messaging in microservices architecture. So in monolithic applications, messaging are based on inter-process communication is based on RPC calls, or in web service context that is based on SOAP messages, and it has multiple operations with complex message schemas. And in microservices architecture, we want to have simple and lightweight messaging mechanisms. So the obvious choice is REST and all the REST-related message formats. So in some cases, there are protocols like Thrift are used to implement microservices, but in for the most part, microservices are exposing a REST API, and different messaging styles are used. Things like for asynchronous messaging, we can use MQTT in most cases, as well as AMQP. And messaging formats, JSON, XML, protocol buffers, or Avro, those are heavily used. And of course, microservices need to have some kind of service contract. So that is often done through, again, REST-specific service contract mechanisms like Swagger, RAML, etc. Okay, so then moving into the data management. So most of the monolithic applications are using a centralized database. So going back to our previous example, we are using a central retail DB to implement our online retail scenario. Microservices architecture recommends us to decentralize data, and to each microservice must have its own data representation. So the key advantage of that is you have the luxury of changing a given schema of a database without affecting any of the existing services. So the key aspects of decentralized data management is each microservice should have its own private database, and it can only access its own private database directly through DB connections. But in case if you have to access, or if you want to modify some of the existing data, that must be done through the service API. So that means inventory maybe the shipping microservice wants to update the inventory database as well. So you need to call that particular operation through the REST API. Okay, so then moving on to the governance. So governance in general is defined as establishing, enforcing how people and solutions work together to achieve a common organization objective. So there are runtime and design time governance. When it comes to design time governance in the microservices world, there is no like a centralized design time governance. That means you are not bound to any particular architecture pattern or technology. So you are free to use any kind of technology across different solutions. When it comes to runtime governance, you might have to use a centralized location like a gateway to apply your runtime governance aspect like throttling or any other SLAs when you are invoking microservices. And then we have the service registry and service discovery concept. So in the web services context, we also have the same concept, but here we are generalizing and simplifying both concepts. So as you know, the service registry is used to hold the metadata of the services, and discovery services are used to discover a given service. So we can use service discovery in two different ways. One is client-side discovery. That means client can be actual client implementation or the centralized gateway that is calling, that is exposing the microservices to the external world. So in this case, API gateway or client calls the service registry and discover the service location. So this is very important in microservices context because the location of the microservices are keep on changing. Right, because we dynamically booting up, spinning up new containers. So therefore, the location, actual location may get changed. So therefore, all the discovery requests must go through the service registry and discover during the runtime. And of course, we can do server-side discovery. That means client is not aware of the discovery mechanism. There is a load balancer who's doing the actual discovery work. So microservices deployment, I think this is one of the most critical parts in microservices architecture. We should be able to deploy and undeploy microservices independently from each other. And also, most importantly, you should be able to scale a given microservice without affecting the other service. That means if you are getting more traffic into your shopping microservice, you should be able to scale only the shopping microservice. And also, failure in one microservice should not affect any of the other existing services. So when it comes to deployment, in order to cater for this kind of requirements, we have the Docker as a standard solution. So it is becoming extremely popular, not just for microservice, but for other deployments as well. So we can package microservice as a Docker container and deploy each service instance as a container, and you can scale based on the container. So you basically increase the number of container instances that you have when you want to scale a given microservice. And this requires some of the other aspects like service registry and service discovery. So that can be done through either things like solutions like Kubernetes, or you can use your own platform as a service features in order to build that. But in this case, like, if you are using Kubernetes, you can use all the discovery services. All the load balancing aspects are coming from the underlying Kubernetes framework. So, going back to the use case, how do you deploy the use case? So here you can have inventory and accounting microservices in a single machine as two different containers. Similarly, so if you want to scale the shopping microservice, you just have to increase the number of containers that you have, container instances that you have. Okay, so moving on to the security aspects, when it comes to security, how do you implement security in monolithic applications? So it is quite straightforward. In the security context, what is the implementation requires to identify who's the caller, what the caller can do, and how do we propagate that information. So this is often done by a handler at the right at the request flow and extracting all the information and propagating data across the entire life cycle of the request. This can be implemented at the microservices level as well, but the only problem is with this approach, you need to call a centralized user store and retrieve all those data, and that logic has to be implemented across the all the microservice. Right? So you need to implement this that particular handler across each and every microservice. So that is not going to work. That is not scalable. And so, but to implement that, we can use widely used API security standards like OO2 and OpenID Connect to give common analogies to OO2. It is like a ticket that you get in a bus or a train. So that has, if you are holding a ticket, you can travel in the bus, right? So that doesn't have your any user information, your user metadata, or any other user attributes in a ticket. But when it comes to OpenID Connect, you have some of your data available. It's like an airline ticket. It has your some of the data, like your name, full name, and some other data available in the airline ticket. So how do we implement microservices security by using these two technologies? So in this case, there is a mobile client who's sending requests to the gateway. So he's using access tokens. And so what the API gateway does is it sends the access token and exchange that access token to a JWT. So JWT, so access token doesn't have any user information. It is a reference token. And when you get the JWT, you have all the required user data. So that is a by-value token. And from that token, you can also look at all the roles available. And only thing that you have to do at the microservices level is to write, implement a JWT processing layer, which is quite simple compared to implementing a security handling layer at each and every microservice level. So this is the commonly used pattern when it comes to implementation of security in microservices. Okay, then we are moving into the most interesting aspect. How do we orchestrate microservices? How do you build solutions by calling multiple microservices? So the architecture principles itself says no ESP in microservices architecture, but does not really say how should we do that. So one possible way of, in some of the articles, they are suggesting to use point-to-point style integration. So you have the client has to take care of invoking multiple microservices. Of course, this is the standard spaghetti integration anti-pattern in enterprise integration context, which is going to be a nightmare anyway. So there are some solutions this will work for like two or three microservices, but not going to work for any complex use case. So then we can do the orchestration at the gateway layer, and gateway has to be lightweight, of course, and the orchestration logic is implemented at the gateway. But there is a issue with this because microservices architecture discouraged to have this kind of a centralized, because gateway is going to be the central point that controls the entire orchestration. And the other solution is you can build another microservice as a composite microservice that can do the orchestration logic, that can implement the orchestration logic. So that means microservice E implements orchestration logic of A and C. So those are three different approaches that you can do orchestration. So I'll come back to this orchestration later when I describe the enterprise application, enterprise mode, how do you use microservices in modern enterprises. So Gartner describes two different architectural principles when it comes to microservices, that is inner and outer architecture. So as you know, microservices architecture brings some lot of simplicity into your application. So your microservices are very simple, very using very lightweight message formats, very few number of operations. So there is a lot of complexity removed from your services, but it hasn't disappeared. It has to be somewhere in your system. So your microservices reside in your inner architecture, while all the complexities has moved into your outer architecture. So what really lacks in most of the current solutions is the support for the functionalities required in the outer architecture. So if I try to map this into a modern enterprise architecture, so let's start with the microservices. Say that you have implemented some set of microservices from A to D, and you want to, of course, you won't be able to move your entire enterprise architecture into the microservices-based architecture. So you have to deal with the existing systems like ERP systems, other monolithic systems, databases. So you need to have some kind of an integration layer. So I'm not calling this an ESB at the moment, because ESB has its own heavyweight and monolithic nature. So we are calling it the integration server. Let's say this is a next generation product that is having all the microservice related architectural principles in it, things like ability to scale, container friendly, and less like very quick startup time. So integration server has to take care of the integrating all the disparate systems, while so microservices reside on your application domain. So it is not residing any of in your business logic domain, and all the QoS and all the design runtime governance aspects has to be implemented at the central point, and that is the gateway, because you have to expose all your microservices as APIs to external world, so that you get the control over the invocation of each and every microservice. And orchestration, of course, can be done inside the gateway or inside the integration server. So the other solution that you can use is the micro integration. So that is kind of a lightweight version of the integration server. So you implement some integration logic, say that you implement the orchestration of microservice A, B, and some ERP system as a single integration flow, and that is a micro integration, and you have the option of scaling that particular flow only as a separate microservice integration, micro integration. So that means you only have a single integration flow that you can scale independently. So that can be deployed outside your integration server. Okay, so moving on to the WSO2 MS4J, there is a separate talk on this by Samira, but this is a lightweight and high-performance framework for building microservices, and we are fully addressing all the microservices needs, because as Sanjeev said yesterday, there are some microservices framework that are not really adhering to the actual needs, like container friendliness, the startup time, etc. So you can attend Samir's talk to get more information on WSO2 MS4J. So concluding, as a summary, we can say microservice is not a panacea. It won't solve all your enterprise IT needs. So this is more or less SOA done right. So most of the SOA principles are implemented in the improper way when it comes to web services, but this is like SOA in the right way. And again, most enterprises won't be able to convert their entire enterprise architecture into microservices, by no means. And still, the enterprise integration is required. It never goes away. And you should try to expose microservices as APIs to the external world. And interaction can be supported through a lightweight gateway or inside another micro integration or another microservices as well. Okay, so I put some of the references as well, blog and the microservices.io, which is a pretty good one.